skills acquisition and personal development are two things that I believe go hand in hand because they feed off each other. And whilst this topic seems standard, because we should all know what both things mean, what is most exciting for me is the fact that I'm talking about it with a 21-year-old. And the assumption for some would be that, what does a 21-year-old know about life at this stage? I'm going to let him answer that himself. Mobolaji Olagbegi, aka Bodge, is a stylist and fashion enthusiast based in London. He recently graduated from the University of Reading, where he studied business management. During this time, he developed his creative skills and now works as creative director, stylist, and fashion designer based in London. He has worked with the Nigerian talents such as Ricardo Banks, Bad Boy Timbs, Kida Kods, and a few others. His most recent accomplishment is his first Vogue magazine feature, which he got at the age of 20. So hopefully that answers the question of what does he know about skills acquisition. So, welcome, Bolaji.
Hello.
I'm super excited to have you here. Oh, good my God, morning. You've got grills.
I actually have grills.
Okay. So, what does skills acquisition mean to you?
Skills acquisition is a constant development of traits and it's pretty self-explanatory. So.
Yeah, it is self-explanatory. Yeah. But so the thing is, why does it matter? You're, what, 21? Why does it matter?
It matters because we're moving into a digital economy and right now, employers and jobs are becoming more than just what's on paper. It's about what more do you know, what more skills do you have? And the more you have, the better. So.
The more you have, the better. Mm-hmm. Okay. Are there any skills that are useless skills?
Definitely not.
Why?
My dad once said to me that we were doing like a training course like 2 years ago, and he said to me that 50% of the skills that the jobs are going to be available when I start working are not around right now, and 50% of the jobs that are going to be available then are going to be extinct. So you can't really no skill is out of pocket. No skill is out of pocket. That's my take on that.
When did you told me earlier about the fact that you started acquiring your skills at a relatively young age. Can you tell me a bit more about that?
The first skill that I would say that I took seriously and started acquiring was graphic design. I started that when I was 15 and in secondary school. At the time, I didn't actually have a laptop to practice on, so I was like working with, I used a book to sort of learn Photoshop, which is pretty hard to do because
I used a book.
I was just very curious. I was literally, it was called Photoshop for Dummies, and they had like graphics on it, so it was pretty interesting. And when I left school and I had access to my laptop, I would like practice and practice on it. But at the time, I didn't really look at it as skill. I wasn't trying to learn a skill. I was just very curious into what I was doing. Huh. I was just very interested.
And how has it come to play today?
Today, graphic design, video editing has been my most marketable, my biggest skill so far. It's what I do now. It's what I did this morning. And it's what sets me apart when I apply for jobs in the creative industry. The fact that I can work digitally.
But then you started randomly learning this skill at the age of 15.
Yes.
When everybody else is just chillaxing and having fun.
Pretty much so, yes.
Huh. Interesting. And have you actually earned from this skill?
Yeah, so...
When did you start earning from this skill?
That's a very good question. I was about 2 years after having my laptop with me, I started practicing on working on designs, and a friend approached me and was like, they were trying to start a clothing brand and they were looking to like outsource graphic design, and for them that was very expensive to do. So I said to them, okay, cool, I'll do it for like a quarter of the price that I was doing it for. So people were paying me like £20 to get graphics done for their event or for this is a university.
How old were you then?
I was 18, 19.
Nice.
And at the time, I didn't even know the value of the skill, because right now, like, I was very much lowballing myself. So I was doing that for events, and at some point, I started doing that for like the student union and school.
Yeah.
They had events every like twice a week, and I was doing the flyers for both events and charging £20 per flyer, and I was doing that for the whole semester.
You were lowballing yourself.
I was very much lowballing myself.
But now you're benefiting from it.
Yeah.
Okay, so what is the correlation between skills acquisition and personal growth?
Personal growth in itself is about skill acquisition. It's about understanding your strengths and weaknesses, developing your strengths, and I use the word developing your weaknesses as well. As we progress in life, the more, like back hundreds of years ago, the more valuable you are, the more your value is associated with the amount of skills you have. If you're good at hunting, if you're good at fishing, these make you a more valuable man. This makes you more useful. And and in this digital economy, the more use you have, the more you can charge, the more, and everything sort of translates with each other.
But then what about, you talked about developing your weaknesses. What do you mean by that?
Weaknesses have been seen as something that you just like accept and you just move on. But understanding that your weakness, like understanding your weaknesses can be your biggest strength. You know, my biggest strength right now are my weaknesses, because I understand how I'm able to identify them and move forward from them, or let them not distract or come into what I have working on right now or impact my day-to-day life.
For a 21-year-old, you sound very astute and super together. How is that? Or is that even a wrong assumption for me to be making?
I don't think so. I don't think so. When I, from young, and I put this mostly to my parents from a long time ago, I've always been like told to think about the future. You know, when I was younger, it did seem like a very far-fetched task. But and the years have gone by very quickly. It was only just 5 years ago, I was like, the other day I was driving past my primary school and realizing that's been 10 years ago. You know, like, and I remember it like it was yesterday. I remember walking through those doors like it was yesterday. So to understand that like 10 years from now is going to fly by very quickly, I have to basically prepare. I have to make sure that I have the skills that I want to have. And yeah.
There's a double-edged sort of perception that young people are more fearless or better risk takers, but also they're more flighty and less reliable. What would you say about that?
My people.
for real though.
I mean, being a risk taker almost means being a risk taker and being flighty almost comes sort of like hand in hand anyway. And to that I mean that being able to like taking risks to me means like going for that opportunity, putting yourself first, and what doesn't suit you. In the same voice, in the same train of thought, that also means like flaking on people if things don't go as planned. You know, like there's a way to communicate, but it means like people have taken it wrongly and they put themselves first. You know, like they put themselves first when they want to like change career, for example. They forget about their employees, their employers, the people around them that have nurtured them. And it may come across as flaky, may come across as, you know, neglect, but yeah, it really is a double edged sword. But there's a way to balance it, you know.
How do you balance it though?
Through communication, you know, like understanding that like everyone around you, to the best of my knowledge, wants to see you do what's best for yourself. You know, but as opposed to flaking, you communicate. You know, you speak, you talk. I'm not going to be able to make this. I don't find this interesting anymore. I want to go pursue this. I want to stop this and do this. You communicate.
What about a situation where you've communicated, but you're still seen as, oh gosh, that person is so unreliable. All these younglings, you know, they're just so unreliable. You know, what do you do then?
I don't know how to answer that.
But does it happen though?
It does happen. It happened to me before. Definitely does happen.
And how did you navigate through it?
I feel like putting myself in a place where I call politically correct, I communicate, and if I'm not heard, if I'm not listened to, I take my own risk and I take my own action and I move forward in my life. Because if you don't put yourself first, no one's gonna put you first.
Very true. And okay, so when it then comes to interacting with your peers, what would you be saying to them about acquiring skills and developing themselves personally?
The one thing I say to my friends is that the youth is on our side. You know, like, we're young, and let's use it to our advantage. We have a lot of time. We don't have as many responsibilities as we think we have, you know. Let's use it to our advantage, you know.
How so, though? What are practical, you know, practical things that somebody listening can actually say, okay, maybe I need to do a mind shift and start thinking about these things differently?
I don't want to be a party pooper, but I promise you, I have a lot of fun. I have a lot of fun. But cutting down and doing things in moderation, you know, like excess drinking, excess smoking, or even drinking, smoking, going for parties, going for places where you're not invited to, you don't belong, it's time that you can use to develop yourself, you can use to develop your skills. And my biggest thing is that time is our most valuable, like, resource. Forget money, forget money. Mm. Time is we can't get back time, but money that we spent yesterday can be earned tomorrow, you know? So using that time wisely, and developing skills takes a lot of time, you know? You don't want to do it under pressure. You don't want to developing a skill. I've developed skills because I want to start a job. That's very different from developing a skill out of curiosity, you know? Skills take time to nurture, they take trial and error, and using your time wisely works out for the better for you. And this is coming from someone who has a lot of fun, you know? I had a lot of fun. So
what you're essentially saying is everything in moderation.
Everything in moderation.
And put things in the right perspective. So what would you then say to, say, for example, parents of people in your generation who sometimes are seen as helicopter parents, and they just hover and, you know, try to control the person's future?
I would say that parents can't see the future. You know, there's so many jobs that I can list right now that were not jobs when I was 8, when I was 11, when I was 12. So my parents sort of forcing me to channel my energy, channel my time into that job. It may not always pan out. So giving your child the benefit of the doubt that you're going to thrive best at what you're interested in, where your heart belongs, you know? Like, I'm going to thrive best when it comes to fashion. I'm going to thrive best when it comes to technology. But when it comes to something like, for example, accounting, like, I'm not going to be myself. I'm not going to be happy. I'm not going to be productive, you know? And overall, like, the way the economy is moving now, like, those things are not, like, back in the day, I believe that the reason why parents neglected people from going into those fields was because they were not high-income skills. You know, but nowadays, those skills are high-income skills.
So you're talking about the skills that didn't exist before?
100%, yeah.
They're now high-income skills. Skills like what?
Skills like styling, you know, like fashion styling. When I left Nigeria, like, that was not an option for something I wanted to go study or anything. And today, like, the most I've ever gotten paid has come from fashion styling.
Oh, wow.
And I've done a lot of jobs before. The most I've ever gotten paid, and when I use the most, I mean, like, in the shortest amount of time, I'm talking about being paid for 8 hours worth of work, has come from fashion styling.
Wow.
Yeah, and yeah.
Interesting. So to round up, can you maybe in 3 to 5, you know, short nuggets, explain to us how we can begin to properly acquire skills whilst also developing ourselves personally?
To do that, I'm going to reference the late Virgil Abloh, and I'm going to say, question everything. You know, question everything. Ask, why is this that way? Why does this person look like this? Why is this the color of this? And from there, move on. You know, find where you look for your interests and research your interests, you know. Everybody's different. What interests you the most? You should know it. If you don't know it, take time to sit back and look around you. Do you get what I mean? Do you notice that you like taking photos on your phone? Do you notice that you like dressing yourself up and you like dressing your siblings up? Do you know that you like arranging the house and making everywhere look nice? And that thing that seems like such a minor skill, or just seems like something that's not too important, is a whole field in itself, you know? Like my mom started off, like, arranging her own house, mm. you know, and just making sure it looks nice before she leaves the house. And 20, 30 years down the line, she's an interior designer. Mm. That's what she does for a living, and that's where she's made all her living, and most of her living, you know. And it's like that one thing that seems like that one place where your brain just is the most active, develop it. Identify first, develop it, and then learn. So learn through like online resources. We have YouTube, that's a free resource that anyone can use. Mm. And keep investing your time into learning and developing those skills till you get to a point where you feel like you're comfortable enough to start a business, to work for a company as that discipline, to charge for your services, you know.
How do the adults around support that, or the older generation rather, you know?
How do they
support
that?
Need to do to actually help enable this, you know, path?
Give them space and don't knock anybody's ideas. You know, don't knock anybody's ideas. Like this, the stupidest, I don't know if I can say that, the dumbest things are what make the most money. It's what makes the most money right now. YouTube, for example, people just going on YouTube and talking about rubbish, quote unquote rubbish. They're making a killing. They're also money. They're also enjoying themselves. Mm. They're also traveling for work. They're also being paid to just appear somewhere. You know, like, and that for me is wild. Even for me, that's wild. You know, so I can't imagine. So I'd say, like, as long as the skill that the person is learning is not detrimental to their health or their mind, give them space to learn it. You know, like, bear in mind, I still went to university, I still did all of that. But give them space to learn.
Mobology, this has been awesome.
It has been.
Yeah, it has been. We've been wanting to do this for such a long time.
We have.
I'm really glad we did. And by the way, I love your shirt.
Thank you so
it's
much.
It's like super duper cool.
I made it actually.
Super duper cool.
Thank you.
So we've come to the end. It always goes by very, very quickly. So I really hope everybody watching has been able to learn one or two things and really listen, not listen to a young person talking, but listen to an adult who actually has value to add, because this has been super interesting for me. So thank you for watching. John, Helen, and myself are going to very quickly round off the show. So please stay with us for a few more minutes. Thank you.